Okay, so we're going to move on now in the program to our second talk. And this comes from Dr. Gabriella Sozzi. She's from Milano in Italy at the Institute Nazionale Tumori. And I think, you know, I've heard a lot about Gabriella's work in the past. And we heard about ctDNA in the first talk from Nick Papadopoulos. And what Gabriella is going to talk to us now is the role as in liquid biopsy of microRNAs, and specifically the incredible work that she's doing on the early detection of lung cancer. So it's a great pleasure to welcome you, Gabriella. The stage is yours.
Hello. Hi, Caroline.
Hello, Gabriella. Can you switch on your video?
I'm doing that now.
Okay, now we can see you.
We are. Let's see if I'm able to manage this. Okay, can you see me?
Perfect.
Good. Thanks. So it's my pleasure to meet you again. Unfortunately, you are not in Bergamo. Last time was a really wonderful time, but we tried to manage in this difficult setting. So yes, these are my conflict of interest. And I want you to spend a few words on a short introduction on lung cancer. Lung cancer is the leading cause of cancer death in the world and accounts for more than 1 million deaths every year. Here are reported that the prevalence of smoking tobacco in several countries. These numbers are really frightening, with over 1.1 billion of smokers and increasing. Although we know that lung cancer five-year survival is quite low, less than 20%, however, we know that if we are able to detect lung cancer before it spreads, the chance for survival improves dramatically. So in lung cancer, more than in any other cancer type, I think early detection is essential to improve survival. We can now say that presently, after smoking cessation, the most effective healthcare intervention for lung cancer is early detection through low-dose computed tomography. And this assumption is based on the results of three major studies. The first one, the NST, already published in 2011, a large-size trial using three rounds of screening over 2 years, which showed for the first time a decrease of 20% in lung cancer-related mortality in the LDCT screening arm compared to chest radiography. The Dutch-Belgian Nelson trial that was published only in 2019 confirmed these findings using 4 rounds of screening over 6.5 years in 15,000 subjects. And in fact, the reduction in mortality was really, really similar to that observed, and even better than that observed in the NST. Last but not least is our MIRD trial, an Italian trial, which provided additional evidence that extended intervention beyond 5 years of screening with the annual or biannual rounds increased the benefit of screening. And this was done in a small size trial, 4,000 subjects, but with a very long follow-up. We observed a reduction of 39% in lung cancer mortality. Nonetheless, the development of blood-based biomarkers, non-invasive biomarkers, is still very interesting and could be really helpful to increase the benefit of screening in at least two settings. The first one is the screening context to better predict lung cancer risk, individual lung cancer risk, and to define personalized LDCT screening intervals, and in the diagnostic settings to resolve those nodules, indeterminate nodules at the CT that makes a false positive rate very high. So potentially biomarkers could be able to decrease the false positive rate of the DCT and lead to a reduction of a subject needed to be followed up. Why microRNA as a cancer biomarker? We started almost 20 years ago, way before the advent of the liquid biopsy era, and with our first studies showing the presence of tumor DNA in blood of lung cancer patients in form of mutations, microsatellite instability, or also methylation changes. However, when we tried to move these biomarkers into a screening setting, they revealed not be useful to detect the early screen detected cancer, the very early cancers. So we focused on another class of biomarkers, such as microRNAs, and the choice was based on the fact that microRNAs are released not only from tumor cells, but also from the lung stromal macroenvironment and from the hematopoietic cells of the host. And therefore, they better reflect changes of the tumor-host interplay and potentially may represent very early changes in a very early response of the host to an incipient tumor growth. MicroRNA, all of you know what the microRNAs are, small non-coding sequences with a regulatory function. They have the advantage of remaining rather intact and stable in biological fluids, since they circulate protected into exosomes or bound into ribonuclear protein complexes that protect them from degradation. They also have the advantage of being quite easily detectable by simple techniques, PCR-based techniques, digital or real-time PCR, that are in also useful, also feasible in clinical laboratories. In our preliminary previous studies, we performed microRNA profiling in plasma of subjects enrolled in a first pylon screening trial and identified 24 microRNAs whose reciprocal ratios were able to distinguish patients versus smokers controls, same age, same smoking exposure, and compose the different signature, either diagnostic and prognostic signatures. For the validation study, we decided to generate a three-level risk categorization of the disease by combining the diagnostic and prognostic signatures into a unique classifier that we called MSC, with three levels of risk, low, intermediate, and high. And we validated the performance of MSC in a testing set composed of almost 1,000 subjects enrolled in the MILD trial with 85 lung cancer detected. And here we could verify that indeed MSC had a quite good sensitivity, 87% and 81% specificity. This was obviously a retrospective analysis of the already prospectively collected samples. So based on these really promising findings, we launched in 2013 the BioMIL trial, which is a lung cancer screening trial based on this biological hypothesis. We posit that lung cancer risk is not homogeneous across age and smoking, but is determined by an individual lung damage. And we predicted that, this risk could be predictable by combining imaging and a blood-based test, such as microRNA. So we hypothesized that personalized prevention could be possible. In the study design, following this hypothesis, we decided to send to a CT, a 3 years LDCT interval, those subjects with both negative tests, a negative LDCT finding, less than this cutoff, and a low-risk Mirna profile. We sent to 1 year, 1 year those subjects with an indeterminate CT findings or an intermediate Mirna risk profile, and to shorter time, interval CT time, like 3-6 months, those are subjects with either a positive findings at CT with a nodule higher than this cutoff, or a NIRNA high risk profile. So specific aims of the trial, I repeat it, was to evaluate the utility of combining the blood test with the imaging to predict the individual lung cancer risk. Importantly, to assess the feasibility of using longer screening intervals in subjects at low risk with the baseline negative findings, and to reveal on the other side the potential damage of prolonging this interval in terms of possible decrease of stage one or decrease of resection rates or increase interval cancer. Importantly, we wanted to assess the incremental value of the blood test in the context of LDCT indeterminate nodules and positive nodules. So we registered up to 10,000 volunteers and we ended up with 4,119 subjects enrolled with this inclusion and exclusion criteria. This subject underwent the CT, blood collection, MIRNA profiling, and spirometry and monoxide evaluation to check for smoking cessation, because all our volunteers are invited to stop smoking in order to go forward in the trial. At the baseline, 58% of our volunteers resulted double negatives with a negative LDCT finding and a low MIRNA risk profile. 37% were single positive, were classified as single positive, having either one or the other positive test. And a very small amount of number of subjects, 5%, were classified as double positive, with a positive LDCT finding and indeterminate or positive nodule higher than this cutoff, and a MIRNA high or intermediate risk profile. Volunteers' baseline characteristics stratified by risk profile are shown in this slide. We didn't find any major differences across the three risk profile concerning to age of the volunteers, smoking history, smoking status. And here are the preliminary results at 4 years median follow-up, with all the subjects having reached 3 years follow-up. We detected 115 lung cancers, accounting for 2.8% of global incidence. And we notice a significant increase in lung cancers, in the number of lung cancers in the double positive group, 20%, compared to the other two risk categories. Lung cancer mortality, lung cancer deaths were also significantly higher in the double positive group compared to the other risk profiles. However, only 3 cancer deaths were observed in the double negatives group. Importantly, we didn't find any increase, a significant increase in interval cancers in our volunteers. Looking at the results within the 3 years, which was the interval at which we sent the double negative subject, only 3 double negatives showed developed lung cancer within this interval. Whereas the number of double positive subjects having cancer was significantly higher also in this time point, at this time point. No major differences were observed in the number, in the proportion of stage one lung cancer or resected cancer across the risk profile. And importantly, only 4 benign resections were done during the trial. Only 4 subjects were resected for benign lesions, accounting for a rate of 4.2%, which is so far the lowest rate reported in a screening trial, well below the threshold of 10%, which is the recommended one by guidelines. So cumulative lung cancer incidence curves, as mentioned before, showed a very significant differences between the double positive subject, among double positive subject versus one positive of double negatives, with a cumulative incidence about 20% in the positive group, and an hazard ratio, an adjusted hazard ratio of reaching 36.64. Lung cancer mortality cumulative mortality curves also were significantly different between the two positive and the double negative or one positive subjects, with an adjusted hazard ratio reaching 32.24. We then assessed the value of the Mirna test within each LDCT category. Here is reported the analysis on the LDCT indeterminate and positive nodules together, where we found the major advantage of using the assay, and where we noticed a very significant increase in lung cancer incidence in the Mirna positive subjects compared to the Mirna negatives in this setting. Nonetheless, also in LDCT negative cancer incidence, this is on your right side, we pick up five cancer cases that were not visible by CT, but unfortunately, four of these five were small cell lung cancer, and therefore with a quite worse prognosis at the end of follow-up. So the clinical benefit of using the MSC test, the Mirna test, in this LDCT negative setting is still to be remained still questionable at the clinical level. We will wait to verify this point. Preliminary messages of the trial. This is the first prospective screening trial testing LDCT and Mirna showing a clinical utility. We have now reached the 5 years median follow-up for all the subjects. And so we will reanalyze the data and finalize the analysis in order to send us the results of the trial. It seems that the blood Mirna plus LDCT, the combination of the two imaging and blood test, allows optimal sensitivity, screening sensitivity, and seems to be able to reduce unnecessary LDCT repetitions. The knowledge of the individual biologic risk by the two assays seems to improve the efficacy and could possibly drive future preventive strategies. I want to add these few slides because we are also scientists. So besides the clinical study, we were very interested to understand the origin, the source of the Mirna composing our classifier. And to this purpose, we performed, we assessed the expression of the 24 Mirnas in cells and in the conditioned medium of different cell lines, not only cancer cell lines, but also stromal cell lines established from our patients, such as fibroblast and endothelial cells, as well as from hematopoietic lineages, such as lymphocytes, platelets, monocytes, and macrophages. And as shown here, we noticed that the Mirna composing the classifier derived mainly, are expressed and released mainly from hematopoietic cells. We confirmed this finding by in situ hybridization approach, collaborating with the team of Claudio Tripodo in Palermo, where we could really confirm that hematopoietic cells express a large amount of our Mirnas, at least a group of them. To confirm this origin and this association with the immune cells, we treated several cell lines with drugs able to induce a switch versus towards a protumorigenic or immunosuppressive phenotype. And indeed, we found out that several of our 24 Mirnas were modulated, showed a clear modulation in the transition towards either a protumorigenic or an immunosuppressive phenotype of these cell lines, supporting an association of our Mirnas with not only with the tumor cells, but also with and probably more more probably with the hematopoietic and stromal components. Given this association with immunity, we therefore performed a multiparameteric flow cytometry profiling of PBNC from a subgroup of BioMUC patients and look at the association of the immune subset with MSC risk profile. And here we notice that indeed, MSC risk profile was associated, significantly associated with an increase in hyper-exhausted T cells, whereas the ADCC-prone NKT cells, which are protective elements, were instead decreased. So these findings really support that an MSC risk profile could reflect an immunosuppressive status. These findings were corroborated also by a tumor immune contexture analysis by gene profiling and by CyberSort tool of 37 frozen tissue samples from the screening detected patients, where we noticed that the MSCI risk profile was also associated with a tumor called the immunophenotype, as shown in this radar plot. Tumor immunophenotype was enriched with Tregs or T-cell gamma delta suppressive cells or M2 macrophages and showed a clear decrease on T-cell cytotoxic or NK cells. Based on this strict relationship with the immunity, in collaboration with the team of Marina Garassino, who had the medical oncology, thoracic oncology unit in our hospital, we look at the performance of our MSC risk classifier in an immunotherapy trial, which is the, called Apollo. In these 111 patients, we look at the prognosis of treated patients, of patients treated with immunotherapy at different lines of treatment with the plasma MSC risk profile. We noticed that our progression-free survival was present, was associated with an MSCI risk profile in MSCI risk patients compared to the intermediate and low-risk profile patients. And this association was also confirmed when looking at overall survival. And so this is the take-home message. BioMILD is the first prospective screening trial combining a blood-based biomarker in a prospective way with low density. As I told you before, the publication is in process. We are really, we have accomplished the median 5 years follow-up for this subject, so we are ready to have data, finalize the data. Circulating Myrna seem to have clinical utility in screening trials to implement imaging findings. We discovered that MSC might associate with an immunosuppressive state, with an immunosuppressive systemic immunity that could signify to a predisposition to develop cancer. And we can now say that the knowledge of the individual risk by Myrna and LDCT might improve the efficacy of screening. And we are further validating this finding in an ongoing H2020 trial. I wish to thank my collaborators, in particular the Tumor Genomics Unit, Mattia Boeri, who performed the MSC algorithm, and Orazio Fortunato for the functional studies, the thoracic surgery, in particular the staff of BioMILD, the head of the staff, Ugo Pastorino, who runs all the screening trial in our place from many years, the medical oncology headed by Marina Garassino, and the collaboration with the pathologist. Thank you all to our supporting agencies and to you for your attention.
Gabriella, thank you. That was really exciting data, and it just shows it takes a long time to get to the results, a 5-year period of your trial. It's great to see the updates and the data pouring out, particularly that linkage with the cold immune phenotype. While we're waiting for some questions to come in, I have a couple. So given what you showed us about the microRNA signature largely to do with the environment rather than the intrinsic cancer cell, does it tell you anything different around the predisposing respiratory problems? So emphysema versus COPD, other types of respiratory high risk for cancer. Mm-hmm. Is the signature distinguishing between these different sort of inflammation that's going on in the lung in those high risk patients?
Mm-hmm. Well, this is a good question. We are now analyzing data in order to clarify this point. In our previous study, the MILD trial, the signature was able to distinguish lung cancer patients versus COPD patients, but the numbers were small. Now we have a larger number of volunteers, so we can really run this analysis more safely. I'll tell you soon, I hope. We hope so.
And one quick one for me, because the questions are pouring in now. How much volume of blood do you need for your screening test?
Oh, we extract the microRNA from 200 microliters, such as a very of plasma. So we pick up 10 ml of blood, but we use only 200 microliters of plasma.
Yeah, that's fascinating. Okay, the questions are coming in. So there's a question here from Anjui Wu. Anjui, do you want to just ask your question and tell us where you're dialing in from? Anjui Wu, are you there?
Yes. Hi.
Hi.
Hi. Hi. Thank you for taking the question. So we're wondering whether your microRNA was detected in the vesicle, like oncosome, exosome, or it's a free floating in the plasma sample. Thank you.
They were isolated from a free floating plasma sample, cell-free plasma samples in this study. However, for a small number of our subjects, we also isolated exosomes, non-oncosome, but exosomes, and look at the presence of about 24 miRNAs in the exosomes, and we noticed a quite good Pearson correlation between plasma cell-free circulating miRNAs and exosome miRNAs, at least for our 24.
Thank you.
But the study was based on the plasma free miRNAs.
Thank you, that's clear.
There's an anonymous attendee, so I will read out their question. With ctDNA studies, we usually filter out the CHIP variants where you actually use the hematopoietic cells. Could you comment on that? And should we perhaps have another look at CHIP variants and what we can learn from those?
This is an intriguing question, indeed, because when we look at the findings of the origin of this mirror, we were quite impressed. They were really released from hematopoietics, mainly from hematopoietic cells. In our interpretation of these findings, we cannot ignore, going back to a screening setting, to an individual risk profile, so to a volunteer who has no cancer, having an immunosuppressive status, which is reflected in the miRNA profiling, could be meaningful. So in order to detect a predisposing status of the subject that is preparing to develop a cancer, when incipient tumor cancer developing, looking at the immune cells is important. Is important. At a genomic level, having contamination, a noise related by these cells could be a problem if you want to intercept the signals for the tumor. But yes, it is also possible that, I remember there is a paper published by a US team, I think NYU University, where they look at the nanostring expression and gene expression analyzing by nanostring in whole blood cells, in PBMC. And they found the signatures associated with a clear cancer development. So I think that looking also at the hematopoietic cells could be interesting.
Thank you. Verena Wally, you have a question. Can you ask your question, please? You have a microphone. Verena, are you there? Maybe she doesn't have a microphone. It's a straightforward question, Gabriella. What is the major advantage or disadvantage for your study of plasma over serum?
We collected plasma from the beginning, and we do twice centrifugation, so it's a clear platelet-free plasma samples, because we want to avoid hemolysis. Unfortunately, our test fails hemolysis. So if hemolysis occurs, MSC can be wrong. So we must be very careful to avoid hemolysis. And if you collect serum, you have hemolysis, because during the clotting phase, you have hemolysis. So this test is sensitive to hemolysis. This is a pity. We would like, would not, but we have to use plasma to run our assay, yes.
Yeah. And whilst we're waiting for more questions, Gabriella, with the plasma you must still have, because you only use the 200 microliters, you know, have you got a ctDNA assay that you're running alongside of your microRNAs, or an ELISA for particular proteins, where you can maybe add the power of a multimodal approach?
Yes, we did. It's a project from a postdoc in the lab. She tried from the patients identified in the screening setting to identify mutations. Also, starting from the mutation she found in the tumor, in several cases, she wasn't able to pick up this mutation in plasma in stage one screen detected cancer. So the ctDNA is largely not useful in our settings. We are really not able to pick up mutation present in the tumor in plasma. We are able to do that in stage three or four lung cancer patients, but not in these screen detect, not successfully in all these screen detected cases. Few cases, yes.
Yeah. But not even if you do the methylation assay?
Methylation, I mean, we didn't try it again. Methylation, to me, are more promising. In fact, I was really amazed by the Annals of Oncology paper about the methylation paper of the GRAIL trial, the CTCJ. But again, this is an epigenetic changes, you know, like MIRNA, so it's not strictly tumor-related changes. And I think this is really promising. We did it in the past. We haven't done yet here. And the problem is more technical, because you need a lot of DNA. And another problem is that very early detected cancer release very few amount of DNA. So it's difficult to have enough DNA to perform, you know, bisulfite sequencing and all the procedure.
Okay, we'll have a bit more about that coming up later today. I have another question here from Saber, S-A-B-E-R, Saber, I'm not sure quite how to pronounce it. Saber, do you have a microphone? Do you want to ask Gabriella your question?
Hello.
Here we go.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, thanks for lecture. So amazing. I'm Sab from China. I want to know which type of microRNA is the good for screening for the lung cancer immunotherapy. Tumor microRNA or no, tumor onco microRNA. If you want to look one panel, which panel should we watch?
Can you please, Caroline, can you please understand correctly? He wants to know which panel of microRNA to use, cancer or non-cancer.
So but are you talking about commercially available panels? So a tumor suppressor panel for microRNA or a tumor oncogene panel for microRNA? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, among the 24 microRNAs we found the majority were overexpressed, and not really the majority, half and half were underexpressed. So looking at the, you know, canonical view on microRNAs, overexpressed microRNA can be categorized as tumor suppressors, because they inactivate some function. But I'm not able to answer your question. Probably they a good balance between overexpressed and underexpressed microRNA is the better combination in order to have a balance. Overexpressed mRNA obviously are more easy to be detected.
For sure. The last question for this session, this speaker is from Amit Arora. Amit, are you have a microphone? Can you tell us where you're dialing in from? And you can go ahead and ask your question to Gabriella.
Sure, thank you. I'm dialing in from Ottawa, Canada. And my question is, did you find any correlation between the expression level of these selected microRNAs in the cells versus cell-free space?
Versus?
The cell-free space, Gabriella.
Well, yes, in conditioned medium. We look at the release of our 24 mRNAs in the conditioned medium of cell lines. We look at the expression in the cells and in the in vitro models. I'm speaking of the in vitro models. We find out that these microRNA are quite well released, expressed and released, a good correlation between expression in cells and release in the conditioned medium, in vitro. In patients, obviously we didn't, I don't know exactly what to look for because we have just blood from this patient. We cannot have access to other samples, unless in patients we have a lung tumor samples.
Yeah, I mean my question is mainly coming from the point that let's say if I want to detect these microRNAs, should I use using the plasma as a sample source is good enough, or you can also detect these microRNAs in the cells, like in the buffy coat.
In the cells, yes. I would say that in the buffy coat, I'm not sure you will find an enormous amount of other mRNAs. What we are looking for is the release of this mRNA by immune cells or other cells that contribute to this release. And it's probably a selected number of mRNA which is released from these cells. Not all the expressed mRNA are released, and not all have a significance. We believe also that the released mRNAs could have a functional role in order transfer information from certain types of cell to others. So I think there is a selection of mRNAs released.
Okay, that's intriguing, and I will have to stop there. We're bang on time. Now we actually, because when you sit on Zoom for too long, you get all sort of itchy and you want to get up and move. So we've got 5 minutes to get up and move. And I'll welcome you back in 5 minutes time at 3:35. Thank you so much, Gabriella.